My name is Mike Dunham. I'm interviewing Perry Green of Anchorage at the David Green & Sons store on 4th Avenue. The date is June 11, 2013. Perry, the purpose for this filming is to record personal memories of histories of Anchorage, with the idea that it will be accessible to the public at some point in time. It remains confidential until you give your approval, and you're under no obligation to answer any questions that I might ask, and when we get tired, we're done.
Fine.
Very good. If we could start with your background, when were you born and where?
I was born in Seattle, Washington, March 17, 1936.
And tell me about your parents.
My parents are Ruth and David Green. My father came to Alaska at about 17 years old and came to Ketchikan and Cordova, and we were in Fairbanks and Juneau, and finally in Anchorage in about 1950.
Mm-hmm. What was the city like in 1950?
Well, in about 1952, as I can earliest recall, I was working out in front of my store at 411 E Street, which was right behind the Wooden National Bank of Alaska, and I was sweeping the front off, and a car drove up, and when he drove up, he said, "Where's downtown?" And I said, "Sir, you've just driven through it." And with that, with his California license plate, he went down the took a right, went down 4th Avenue. And it didn't change much. You know, we're sitting here right between A and B on 4th Avenue. And virtually the same thing happened about 1955 or 56. Carr drove up and said, he had come right down 4th Avenue all the way from where I don't know, and right in front of the store said, "Where's downtown?" I said, "Sir, you've just driven through it." And of course, I realized that the highway really didn't open up very much until about 1946. And I remember 4th Avenue back in the early days. I remember Dicey Hayes had a little sewing shop down on 4th Avenue on D Street. Her son later became Speaker of the House, Joe Hayes, and served many years. And of course, we had the Union Club down there where the guys who were union were working down there. Across the street was a bar and another bar and another bar. And of course, we had Kozlowski's and Sons Menswear, the old Dykes Building down there. We had the Anchorage Grill. We had the, it was just 4th Avenue was the center of the town.
What was social life like in Anchorage?
Well, social life was pretty much, we had the 4th Avenue Theater and later the Denali Theater. And the Denali Theater was where the Matanuska Bank became down there. And then there was a Denali Theater also at the corner of 4th and B prior to the earthquake, when it fell during the earthquake.
And your lifelong career has really been helping manage the family business as a furrier. Mm-hmm. What were your first responsibilities?
Well, my first responsibility was to vacuum the store and sweep the sidewalk, as you very well know. But having worked on the Alaska Railroad as a Gandy dancer on Hurricane Sherman and Shaletna and Gold Creek and during the summertime as an 18-year-old kid, I learned a lot about working and responsibility. And but my actual first job was taking these little nails that you used to, when you stretch skins, you'd wet skins and you'd stretch them, and then the nailers would pound the nails into the, or all around the outer perimeter of the skin, and when they bent one, they'd throw it over their shoulder. Well, my brother and I, at the end of two or three days, we had to take a push broom, sweep them up, take them and bend them back. And in the old days in Anchorage, you know, we didn't have all the duct tape and all the tapes that you have today. When we get a package sent in from outside, we take the cord that you wrapped it with, we would untie it, we would take the tissue paper inside, we would stretch it out, and we would then when we had a box that we had, we would then take that same box, put the tissue back in the box, take that cord, wrap it, and send it to the post office, because that's the way you did things. Every dollar counted, every penny counted, and even though those little nails that we had to straighten out when we were kids, they were like 10 for a penny. But that's how you build a business.
How did you go about acquiring the furs?
Well, the trappers used to come in, and during fur rendezvous time, they came in. And my father had a great reputation, and prior to that, he would go out and seek them. But I, about 1964, started to go out on my own. I had Anchorage Fur Trading Company at the time, and I traveled the Alaska Highway, and I picked up the furs going up all the way to Tok and into Canada near Snag, and went up to Fairbanks and back down the highway, and then later went via planes with Don Sheldon and various bush pilots, probably bush pilots if I were to take all my fingers and my toes and add them all together, about 98% of those bush pilots are gone. I remember vividly being up in Barrow one time, and I remember being in Bethel one time. I was with Fort Yukon Air Service, and I had refused a flight with Jules Thibedeau. And Jules Thibedeau, every time I was out on something, Jules Thibedeau was down in the Arctic. And there was, he says, but don't worry, I'm walking in. I'm 90 miles out on the ice pack, but I'm walking in. And then when I went to Fort Yukon Air Service, and Al Wright couldn't take me, he says, but I got a pilot for you. I says, who is it? He says, well, it's Jules Thibedeau. I says, I'm not going. And then I had gone down the Kobuk and the Yukon River, and I'm finally in Bethel, and we get the news that Jules Thibedeau had gone to Glen Allen to pick up a couple of kids. They used to have a Catholic school up there where the native children used to come in, and he was missing, and they found him 6 months later, and I didn't fly with him that time.
What were some of the trappers like? What were these guys like?
The trappers were as tough as anybody in the world. They were as independent as can be. The natives were very resourceful, very intelligent. In fact, it's always been a wonder to me why everybody thinks that just because you have a degree from a university that you're considered educated. You might be educated, but you're not as smart as some of these trappers. I remember out in a village one time, and I would go out with a bag full of cash, and I would take my cash out in the village, and I would then, in order to have a record of it, I would have them sign a check for the amount that it was, and I'd always ask them, can you sign your name? And they'd be so proud, and they would sign their name with an X. But I never, ever denigrated that person, because that person made a living ever before there was a Bureau of Indian Affairs that started to take care of them. In fact, when the Bureau of Indian Affairs came into the villages, one of the problems was that the people who were productive and who had built a little better hut or home, if you were not gainfully a trapper or a resource person, they would come in and they would take care of you. And when the people who were struggling for their families and their existence and to do something, when they saw that, they quit being productive because they said, why am I working hard? Why am I doing it when for nothing you can become something? And that's why sometimes they feel so much government has really ruined Alaska, changed Alaska. Even though at that time, I remember the early days when we had to go from Seattle to Anchorage, we had to show them a passport to get in and out of the United States.
How did you travel between Seattle and Alaska?
Well, my father basically was, he came up with steamships and all, but I came later back to Alaska with the DC-3s and the DC-4s and the old Western Airlines and the old, which later merged into Delta Airlines and all. And it was a long trip in those. The Lockheed Electric Electras were the airplane of the day, as I remember as well.
Mm-hmm. About how long did it take?
You know, I think it took about 5.5-6 hours. I mean, when Northwest came up here, they brought what was called a strato cruiser, and I think that might have been, I don't know, 1949 or 50. That was huge. That was a big thing, and that cut it down. Maybe it was 6 hours. Time dulls your memory.
Right. What were politics like in Anchorage? I mean, downtown is kind of the core of the city, as you said, and your father was on the city council?
Well, my father was on the city council with, I think it was Joe Turinsky and Chet Hostetler, and the mayor at that time was Elmer Rasmuson, who my father called the most intelligent and brightest man who ever was in Alaska. He was very, even though he opposed him on many issues, he had the utmost respect for him. And about 15 years after my father had passed away, Elmer passed me on the street, even though they were enemies on the city council. He stopped me and he said, you know, Perry, of everybody I've ever served with on the city council, I had the most respect for your father, David Green. I said, I appreciate you saying that. And he said the same about you.
What were the issues that they were facing?
Well, it was always growing pains and how to best grow the city and who to allow certain things to what it was, you know. Anchorage was a city that was fortunate indeed to be geographically become the crossroads of the world. What really built Alaska was the, initially it was the fur traders who had the interest to buy Alaska and purchase Alaska. But later on it was the military that kept up our Alaska communication system. You know, we used to listen to all radio, and when we listened to radio, if it was a sporting event, we had Ruben Gaines giving us a delayed broadcast of how it was going. Well, they got the ticker tape, and it was that's how radio was in Alaska. And then, of course, we had some of the early pioneers, the fellow who started Kenai TV. We had
Augie
Hiebert out of Channel 11. I remember back about 1953 or 54, We did a live television show of our furs on television on Thanksgiving. I mean, it was just a half hour, and people watched it with, it was the next day we were inundated with customers about things they had seen on TV, and we did it every year for 5 or 6 years after that, and it was the biggest hit in Anchorage television. It's kind of like the reality shows of today.
Did you go to their studios to do that?
Well, we went to Channel 11 at that time, was at the end of 4th Avenue here in the two buildings that were built during the Reconstruction days, the I Street building, and they were supposed to be hotels or apartments at that time. They were built by a very forward-thinking contractor in those days. And it was in the basement.
It's what we now call the MacKay Building.
MacKay Building, yeah. Right. Mm-hmm. Then it was the state offices building later.
Right. What do you recall about statehood, the time, the era around statehood? What were people saying and doing?
Well, I remember that statehood was a hotly contested issue. We had the biggest proponent for statehood was Bob Atwood, and the biggest, the other, he was on the Republican side, and the other big proponent for it was our former territorial governor, was Bill Egan, speaker. He was the speaker when we when we became a state, Bill Egan was a fabulous individual. Bob Atwood was fabulous. The Chamber of Commerce in those days was a chamber that was pro-business. And pro-business, that's why Anchorage grew and other cities didn't grow. We had a great Chamber of Commerce. We had, our town was a small town. You know, our city hall was on 4th Avenue where the Alaska Visitor Bureau is today. You know, we had our little jail, we had our magistrate there, and then the, of course the jail moved up to 6th and C. We had Mulcahy Park at the corner of 6th and C where we played baseball at, and we had the Alaska Baseball League, and it was pretty impressive.
Did you attend any schools in Alaska, either grade or high school?
Well, I mostly went outside the school. Mm-hmm. And I attended the Anchorage Community College and later came back and actually taught at Anchorage Community College. But what did I teach? I taught poker.
How did you get interested in games of skill and chance?
Well, about 1964, 60. No, about 1968 or 69, the Value Mart opened over here at corner of Benson and the Seward Highway. And they had a great big box, and you put your name in there. You could win a round trip to Las Vegas for two. And I was shopping there, as everybody was, just to look at it. And so I put my mother's name and my wife's name and my name into this great big box. And that night, evening, I went out to Elmendorf Air Force Base for a reception. And when I came home, my kids said, "Guess what? Guess what?" I said, "Well, we won a trip to Las Vegas." Well, that was the beginning of a little career that I didn't think much about because I had played a little poker, but I went down there with $1,800 and I gave my wife $900 and I only had two nights and 3 days at the hotel, and at the end a fella had told me to go downtown, there's a poker game that it's lowball and that he knew I was a good low ball player because I had played at the Elks Club in the, here in Anchorage. And I went downstairs and my wife called me and she said, honey, we've had to move out of the hotel because you only got 2 nights and 3 days. I said, well, that's okay. Come on down in your nicest fur coat because I'm just having the most wonderful time. She says, are you drinking? She says, you know better than that. I don't drink. He said, well, come on down here. It's called the Horseshoe. I didn't even know where downtown was. And she came down and she saw I had like 18 or 20 black chips in front of me. She said, are black chips the same as our at our hotel? Yes, they're $100 chips. I says, and these are mine too. And I went 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I had 7 boxes of black chips filled. I had taken that $800 and I had about almost $80,000. And I said, I don't know what, but I owe Crittenden, Cassetta, Wyrum, and Jacobs, I owe them $10,000. I own some property at the corner of 15th and C all the way to where Mulcahy Ballpark was. I owned the section there. And I said, they were designing me architect's rendering for a building. And so I said, well, take this box of chips down to the bank and send $10,000 off to them before I lose it back. So she takes it and walks down the street of Las Vegas with $10,000 worth of black chips, comes back about 20 minutes later and says, they don't take them down there. I said, gee, I guess you got to cash them in here. I don't know. So she found out and we cashed him in there and I left Vegas and it was a great trip and that's what began a poker career that's even I'm leaving tomorrow for Las Vegas.
And you participated in the World Championships?
Yes, I won 3 World Championships, been second in the main event and 5th in the main event and placed numerous times, but I just played for the fun of it.
And you said it helped you build your house.
Well, in 1981, I got second in the world, and I had enough left over after paying my taxes and everything that I built my house on Lake Otis and been there ever since.
When you first came to Anchorage, when your family first came here, where did you live?
We lived, we lived above the store, and then I lived, during my Army years, I lived in a couple of basements, and then I got Alaska Housing Authority. I lived over at 9th and C, across from the Haun Apartments. I lived actually at the corner of 3rd and B. There was a duplex down there, but during the earthquake, all that's pretty much disappeared. It has disappeared.
What were your years in the Army?
I was in the Army. I left Alaska in 1956. And went down to Seattle to, left in 1955. In fact, that was the year we had the great big snow. And I'm in the Empress Theater in Seattle, and I see the great big snow in Alaska, in Anchorage, in the cars. And there is our store. And we were at 411 E Street at that time, which was in back of the National Bank of Alaska. And there was great, we had a big old man fur sign. It was whistling snow, you know, blowing snow. And it was one of the first neon sign, so to speak. And they put that on the screen. I said, that was really amazing. In fact, I took off in 1955 from Northwest Airlines, left from Elmendorf, because the Anchorage airport was closed down at the time. We didn't have all the snow equipment we have today to handle it.
And then you enlisted or were drafted?
I enlisted. I served 3.5 proud years.
And what were you doing during the earthquake?
Well, that's an interesting story. We had Arctic Fur and Leather between D and E Street, and I had just my oldest son and oldest daughter were there. They had just gone to a movie at the Fourth Avenue Theater with the Kaufman girls, Craig Kaufman and his wife, and he was the dentist, Craig Kaufman, and their father-in-law was Ray Wolf, who used to be the mayor of Anchorage, and they were in the store, and I took my son down to the Dykes Building, which is a wooden building between D and E Street, and this wooden building, took my son by the hand and said, okay, are you ready to get a haircut? And he starts shaking his head, first haircut, and he starts shaking his head, no. Just at that time, we had a little shake, and we had a lot of shakes in Anchorage in those days. And it kept shaking and shaking. Finally, he jumped down the chair, and I grabbed him, just at that time, it's Chattanooga's barbershop. The barber grabbed my daughter, and just at that time, the window snapped and broke and cut the shard of glass, cut him in the hand. And we said, do you think we ought to go outside? So we went out to the middle. We made our way out to the middle of 4th Avenue while it was still shaking and rumbling and rolling. And we're standing on the 4th Avenue, and across the street was, it was just rolling like waves in an ocean. And they were pretty good. And every 10 yards or so, the earth would open and close 6 inches, open and close 6 inches every 10 yards. And then finally, it opened about 12 to 14 inches, and it slammed shut. And when it slammed shut, all the buildings on the other side of 4th Avenue tumbled down about 50 to 60 feet, 40, 50 feet. All the Anchorage Grill, everything that was over there. The only building left standing was the drugstore on the corner, Hewitt's Drugstore. And Hewitt stayed, and I watched the old Westward Anchorage Hotel tipping back and forth and going back and forth. And I had noticed when I got out to the middle of the street, I kind of walked, tried to get back to where I had left my wife and two of the kids, and I noticed we had a linoleum floor in our Arctic Fur and Leather store, and we had a brown bear, and was on a 10-inch pedestal, and it had wheels on it, and here's this brown bear with its claws up in the air going back and forth. And I had watched that with a little bit of glee and a little bit of amusement. But here, huddled in the corner, was my wife, two kids, and the lady that ran the store while that bear was going back and forth. And then, while I was in the middle of the street, I had, just prior to that, I had known that my father had gone to the Anchorage Athletic Club, which had gone down. And of course, all the young men with towels wrapped around their bodies. They were out there, they were shaking, they were nervous, and they were in the middle of Fourth Avenue, and they were scared to death, all the guys with the big muscles. And the ladies with the gray hair were praying to their various denominations to God help them. And so I finally took my two of my kids back to my wife, and I said, you better go home. And I said, but I saw my father had been down the street and down there, and the masseur had come out, and Famous Amos was his name. And I went down the stairs, and the lockers were tumbled one over another, and there was nobody in there except my father sitting on the massage table. And he was muttering to himself, the damn fools did it. The damn fools did it. I said, Dad, what are you talking about? He says, the Russians, they dropped the atomic bomb. I said, no, no, they didn't. It's an earthquake. So he said, run down and see how your mother is. And of course, mother lived above the store here. And it was Good Friday, and it was also the first night of Passover. And so my mother had baked a lot of food and everything, and all her Passover dishes were sitting on the, you have special dishes mm-hmm. for Passover. They were all sitting on the edge of her countertop, and they all fell on the floor. I said, Mother, come out here. So I induced her to come out here, and she saw, well, we had one little light that was hanging, and then I said, but look across the street. The theater is down, all the buildings on the other side of the street are down below. And she said, oh my goodness, oh my God, oh, it's terrible. Go see how your father, now she wants me to go see how my father is. But my father said, it's, you know, when the water was cut off, he says, I finally get to brush my teeth with whiskey, which was pretty much the feeling of Alaskans in the old days. They kept warm with whiskey.
What was the Jewish community like in Anchorage as a young man?
Well, we had a very small but vibrant community. We had the Gottsteins and the Kozlowskis. You know, the early fur traders were in all cities in Alaska. There were Jewish people all over Alaska. Alaska, if it hadn't been for the Jewish fur traders, Russia might have been sold to the English, or it might have been not bought at all, because they convinced Senator Cowles of California to talk to his childhood friend, who was Secretary of State at the time, William H. Seward, that Alaska was not just a land of ice and snow, but it was abundant in minerals and opportunity, and it was a wonderful investment, and that proved extraordinary. So we have a lot to thank for with our fur heritage in Alaska. The Jewish community was very strong, very united. We had a Jewish mayor years ago, and Zac Loussac, character in his own right. If you could probably find him playing pangingi, which is a Filipino rummy game that's popular in native villages. And you could always find the mayor when you needed him, when he was at his pharmacy. You know, Phil Gordon was the main barber at the Anchorage Hotel, where our Sidney Lawrence used to trade his paintings for a haircut and something to eat. You know, in the old days, a Sidney Lawrence wasn't worth what it is today. You know, and the Gottstein family was started out just hauling supplies and groceries and provisions up here, and was a purveyor to all the outlying villages. And then he eventually partnered with Larry Carr. They became the Carr Gottstein properties and grocery chain. Done a great deal for both Catholic Jewish charities and for Alaska in general. And as far as early Alaskan politics, you would have law firms that were both Republican and Democrat. You would have consensus always about what is best for Alaska. They may fight for the election, but the politicians, much like Ted Stevens they always had Alaska as its focal point. What's good for Alaska? And you know, I remember Rivers was our first congressman. I remember Mr. Pollock as our second congressman. I remember every gubernatorial candidate. People would go to individual businessmen try to raise money. Labor was interested in politics, and I remember E.L. Bartlett got $5,000 one time from bumblebee tuna, and that was a big amount of donation in those days. It was like $25,000 to elect a U.S. senator. And Bob Bartlett was one of those kind of guys, when he ran for office, he didn't forget the little people. When he came back to the Westward Hotel, he conversed with the maid. He conversed with the bartender. That was the same about Governor Egan, people didn't have PR the way they had today. I mean, when we lost Ernest Gruening through a very slick PR campaign, that was the end of American politics and statesmen. We don't elect statesmen today. We elect people who have the best PR campaign, who look good for the cameras, and who they say, oh, those are my issues. They create the issues and they take polls. There was no polling in the old days. You were really based, you were elected upon your record, and your record spoke, and that's how you got reelected.
Let's talk about some of these guys. Ernest Gruening, what were your personal impressions?
Well, Ernest Gruening was probably the most brightest guy coming out of the, he was territorial governor and did a lot for Alaska. He had a big connection because during the FDR years, it was Franklin Delano Roosevelt who I think might have nominated him to come to Alaska. Because he was part of the brain trust that got this country, and I don't mean just Alaska, but the United States, working again. And they started the CCC Corps, the Civilian Conservation Corps, that got people working in Idaho and building trails and fixing up national parks, the systems we had today. We had a very great thing. And Ernest Gruening, had it not been for the Tonkin Resolution, would have gone on to be better remembered than he really was in Alaska, because the Tonkin Resolution probably was the thing that has really hurt America, the America's future. We've been involved in so much warfare because of the Tonkin and the Tonkin Resolution. We spend a lot of our manpower in an area where we had no economic understanding. It was really Kennedy's war. It really was. It started under Kennedy. And that's what started me. I used to be a staunch Democrat, even went to the 1972 Democratic Convention, but I walked out and I said, you know, I'm no longer a Democrat.
Did you meet Mr. McGovern?
I was actually a Jackson supporter because I remember during the earthquake, it was Magnuson and Jackson and the congressman from Arizona that came up here, and it was Ernest Gruening that I will give the Kennedy White House credit. The Small Business Administration was giving out loans within about 48 hours to people. You just, if you wanted $3,000, you could get $3,000 right away with no interest. If you wanted more than that, you got the $3,000, but then you had to start paying interest after 1 year. And then, a lot of people really built this place up after that. And I know that Dan Cuddy was responsible. He built his big bank building right after the 64. And the rebuilding here was incredible.
The what was Bill Egan like personally?
Bill Egan could, if he met you once, he could remember you. And if he met you more than once, he'd know your wife's name, your children's name, and almost their birth dates. And it was just remarkable. I met Bill Egan when I was at TKL Roadhouse, and even before he was the Tennessee Plan Senator, or whatever he was back in Washington, D.C., when they lobbied for statehood and finally got it under the Eisenhower administration, he just remembered everybody. He was a fine businessman because he ran a grocery store, and he knew everybody. And the grocery people in those days, the Barrett Lesh, you know, Larry Carr, you know, a lot of people are familiar with Carr's grocery store, but I remember Carr's grocery store starting out. I remember Larry Carr himself. He was about 6'6", and he was reaching up to the highest part of the store. You know, we had Maury Reese with the C Street Foodland right on the store, right on the corner and right on your way home. That was his slogan. You know, everybody in town knew everybody. So everybody had everybody's interest at heart. The banker had your interest. The worker had your interest. And I remember that in the old days, children used to come to our store, and we used to have summer employment. We didn't have McDonald's. We didn't have the little places where teenagers like to go to work. But today, too many teenagers don't know how to work when they come into the workforce, and we don't have a workforce anymore. And other nations are passing us by both educationally and productively.
We were talking about the Anchorage Jewish community in the early days. Where did you guys meet for services?
Well, we were fortunate to have Jewish chaplains in those days, and we went to Fort Rich or Elmendorf. If it was an Army Jewish chaplain, it was at Fort Rich. If it was an Army Air Force Jewish chaplain, it was at Elmendorf.
Was there any security going in and off the base?
I think you had to go through, but there wasn't the security you'd have today to get on. You didn't have to have a pass or anything. You just say, I'm going to the chapel, or you say, I'm going to Chapel 3. It was a lot less stringent, or that's what it was.
How did people in Anchorage feel about having this base with the sidewalks and everything at a time they didn't have pavement in town?
Well, we didn't have much pavement in town. In fact, interesting story, we had a mayor at the time who owned an asphalt company. And Ken Hinchey was his name. And Ken said, what, I can't sell asphalt to the city? No, not while you're mayor. So he resigned from mayor, and he had his asphalt company, because that was, you know, he had to make a living, because the mayor only paid about $300 a month, And he had a big family. He had to get along. He had, that's the way it was. But Hewitt Lounsbury, who was a surveyor at the time, he didn't get any city contracts. He had to do territorial contracts, or he had to do federal contracts. That's the way the city was.
How did the pipeline change things?
I think it brought a lot of people with who didn't understand Alaska, didn't understand the native population, didn't understand what Alaska really is. I think the pipeline focused. I think people got used to, they let government, state government, federal government, city government, municipal government, balloon itself without increasing the educational opportunities. Now, there's greater colleges, there are greater universities, but it costs so much more than it did when we only had the University of Alaska in the old days. And with all the wealth that has come out of the pipeline, we've not used it to build a really functioning infrastructure in Alaska, which would have aided us a lot. We've taken and created a dependency with our permanent fund that people think it's their money, and it is their money. But I think the permanent fund in the beginning might have been a smart idea, but too many people have come to Alaska just for the welfare and the permanent fund benefits that Alaska has to offer. And that's what's changed the beautiful part that I remember about growing up in Alaska.
What did you most like about Alaska in your youth? I mean, this beautiful part.
Oh, I think the lack of government, the fact that a person like Carl Brady could go to then Mayor Sullivan, Carl Brady Jr. could go to, he was head of the Boys Club of Alaska. They didn't have much of a place. We closed down three schools about 1979 or 1980. He went to the mayor, and on the back of a napkin, he agreed on behalf of the Boys Club of Alaska to take over, repair the Woodland Park school, and make it into the Boys Club facility for $1 a year. And he even wrote it on the back of a napkin, what they agreed to, got a 20-year lease, fix up the school. And you can't do that today. You have rules and regulations and EPAs and people looking at you. And it today we have thousands of kids that are the beneficiaries of Carl Brady Jr. and George Sullivan making that deal. And I remember I had a underground contract with the city. I was partners in FFG Construction. And I had a contract. We were a low bidder, and we knew the ground was bad. And we bid the fill in there at $2.50 of a yard for gravel, and everybody else just didn't think there was a lot. Well, it turned out needed 60,000 yards of gravel, and so our bid became really the high bid, and the department didn't want to pay it. And so I went to George Sullivan. I said, you know, we bid it in good faith. We were low bidders. We didn't know. Maybe it would have only taken 6,000, but it took 65,000. Well, and the engineering department didn't want to pay. And so I went before the city council, and George Sullivan said, you made a deal, you honor it. And I never forgot George Sullivan to this day, and I love the band for that. And I stood there, and but I was out. I remember the old days. We had the utility company, Spenard Utilities. And I did all the underground for Spenard Utilities. And at the end of the season, they couldn't pay me. So I said, well, don't pay me, just pay me 8% interest and pay me at the start of next season if you can. They said, okay. So they paid me the 8% interest, and I had a job waiting for me at the end of the season. But then Spenard Utilities got sold to the city, and I said, well, I'm out of here.
Where did you do the work in Spenard? What part of
that? Well, we did it in all the subdivisions outside of the city. The city was very small at the time, and all the subdivisions that are now incorporated within the city were all up for bid.
When they said Spenard, what territory did they mean? Not just Spenard Road?
It was Spenard Utilities. It was started by Ken Cadow Sr., who was also, he started First Federal Savings and Loan, which used to be located here, which all the savings and loans went broke during the Keating days or whatever they were called. There's only one bank today that there's been, just like furriers in the history of Alaska, if you didn't pay attention to your business, you're gone, you're out of here. Like David Green has seen 100 furriers come and go. Well, there's only one bank, basically, that is still the only bank that's still in Anchorage, and that's the, used to be the First National Bank of Anchorage, and now I think it's called the First National Bank of Alaska, since the National Bank of Alaska merged with Wells Fargo.
Right. Dan Cuddy's bank.
Yeah.
The 4th Avenue scene, now before the earthquake, sitting where we are here on 4th Avenue, what would we have seen across the street?
Well, we would have seen the bowling alley was across the street, the coffee cup was on the corner, there was a emporium that was owned by, he became the secretary, I can't think of his name.
What did he sell?
He just sold work clothes in those days. And we had a little hotel here at the corner of 4th and A. We had a little hotel over here. It was a working man's hotel. We had a corner of 4th and C right before we had the fire where Albert Kaloa Jr. was burned up. He was head of the Indian tribe over here at Cross Cook Inlet. We lost 3 or 4 people, but we had the Silver Dollar Loan that was owned by Al Getty, and then we had a Bill Bittner, I think that senior, owned a little pinball machine place with partners, and then we had Hustlin' Russ Meekins on 5th Avenue. You know, you had Austin Simons, later became Friendly Ford, and then it became John Stepford. You know, everybody here who owned a car agency was an Alaskan. Today you have all these corporations that own. They own the big groceries. They own the big box stores. They own the places. Everything was owned by somebody. Piggly Wiggly was Barrett and Lash. You know, you had the insurance companies were small and individual. You had Jack White and Romig, and then you just grew. That's what the pipeline brought. It brought prosperity, and big stores come to prosperity.
Just a second, Perry, I wanted to remind you it's 10 after 11.
Yeah, I really have to leave.
Okay, that's fine.
But we could do it another time if you want more stories.
Well, let's, if we can just maybe
wrap it up.
Yeah, give me a summation. What do you, What do you see Anchorage becoming in the future?
Well, friends of mine have told me that they'll probably live long enough to see Wasilla being a larger city in Anchorage, because Anchorage is running out of room. Well, Anchorage is one of the largest cities, but we are bordered by the Chugach National Park, and we are limited, but perhaps we'll see Anchorage reach out and annex more land here. I'd like to see some more development along the highway there. I would envision Wasilla growing to a large city if we have forward-thinking people and we keep that agricultural base there, and that they allow for it and understand that they'll need open spaces, and that living in Alaska is wonderful, and that I'm glad I raised my children and my children's children here, and that there's a great future for Alaska, and it's all because of those fur traders that prevailed upon Senator Cowles in California to to the Secretary of State, William H. Seward, that Alaska was indeed not a land of ice and snow, but of great future.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.